I think, is a very unknown quantity. And quantity it certainly is. Tony Gwilliam has just spent 3 weeks very recently in China. Tony, what is it like?
Well, number one, let's have a look at China and what... I spent 3 weeks in China, but I really spent it mostly on the eastern side of China, which is this part. We must remember that China actually is a large continent, which includes Tibet and Inner Mongolia as autonomous regions. And it's about the same size as the United States of America. We traveled, entering through Hong Kong, we traveled up north, stopping at various points en route to Peking, which is here, about the same latitude as Madrid, and then traveled across and then down again, flying the last part of the route and out through Hong Kong. Other routes into China would be via the Trans-Siberian Railroad, Vladivostok, either coming around to the USSR here, which we must remember has a border with China right round, or coming along the Trans-Siberian Railroad and then cutting down across Mongolia into Peking, or flying straight into Peking. There's many of the airways, the French Airways and the Ethiopian Airways and so on, are now flying straight to Peking. The route we chose was the cheapest. We have Taiwan here, which is likely to go back to China. It's considered to be part of China by the Chinese. And we have Japan here, which is now making a large number of trade agreements with China. And we must remember that culturally and ethnically, there are many, many relationships between Japan and China. Japan being highly industrialized now, buying a lot of oil from China, and China not having the industrialization, but having a lot of the raw materials. So I think we'll see a lot of relationships between those two in time.
Under what auspices did you go? I mean, was it an official party or what?
Yes, for some years I've been interested in China, and 2 or 3 years ago I organized a Chinese exhibition and speakers in the school. Because there's a quarter of the world's population actually live in China, and we know so little about it, and I felt that it was very important for us to be aware and study some of the alternatives that they're living through. At that time, I came into contact with the Society for Anglo-Chinese Understanding, and they're the main body. They have 3 trips a year to China, about 20 people each trip, and they're either for 2-week or 3-week duration. The Chinese, there are so many people wishing to go to China that the Chinese...
That's at the moment is the only way you can get in, is it, basically?
No, there are even cook's tours into China now. I wouldn't recommend really going on an ordinary sort of standard tour, because it's well worth studying China pretty thoroughly before you go, and the group of people you go with, if they're aware too, you could pick up so much more. Mm. And we actually met together for 6 months before we went, so we knew each other and really maximised the time we were there.
Mm. Which was 3 weeks.
Yeah.
Well, how much did you manage to see during that time?
We managed to see a tremendous amount, I guess. How much we absorbed, I don't really know. I was getting up usually about 5:30 in the morning, if possible, and working through till 11 o'clock at night. The reason for the long hours was we had a very full program the Chinese had organized for us, because they want us to see as much as they can. They don't want to break down your health in the process, because it's kind of big things, stepping off jumbos in different parts of the world, different climates. But they want you to do as much as you can in 3 weeks. And in order to get extra activities in, like if you wanted to walk through the city by yourself or through the countryside, you really had to sort of, you know, stretch your day. So one of the best things to do was really get up very early and then go for a walk in the early morning. And the Chinese will get up early. They will get up at 5:30 or so, then they do their exercises and Tai Chi Chuan and acrobatics and different sorts of sword dancing, like the Wushu thing, the martial arts, in the early morning before they go to work or to school. So there are a lot of things happening in the summer season. Of course, the temperature in different seasons in different parts of China will change the times, of course.
Mm. But the things you were talking about, the martial arts and the Tai Chi Chu, which is some kind of movement thing, is it?
Yeah.
And they're fairly universal. I mean, that kind of everybody does them at 5:30 in the morning. Or
Tai Chi Chuan. There's a lot of films shown of the big mass movements when everybody did physical exercises in the mornings. I think that was under the sort of Russian sort of time, the big influence when everything was done in big mass things, mass rallies in Tiananmen Square and May Day and things. Now, the Chinese have really gone away from that. And you'll see in some of the posters that we're using for illustrating why we're talking now. Some of them you'll see the Russian influence in them, the sort of dramatic poses and things. But now the Chinese have gone away from that, and they're very much more into the people and the smaller community. And so a lot of these exercises and things are just done in the little parks, and the people just do them themselves. And you might find, for instance, in Tientsin, in the mornings, I noticed in the park that the children, quite a few children were there, sort of doing acrobatics, and there was a young bloke teaching them. Now, he would probably just go into his factory afterwards, the bloke who was teaching them, but he'd just teach them in the spare time. The children were doing these tremendous flips, flops, and somersaults and things. It's very, very integrated, not, but it isn't a mass movement.
It's not a mass movement, but somehow if a lot of people are doing it all over the place, it must be.
Yes, you know, but not centrally controlled. Yeah. It's doing just because they enjoy doing it. Mm. It's a nice social thing before you start work in the morning. It's also traditional. The Chinese have always sort of been very interested in the relationship between the body energies and the energies of the earth outside. And so a lot of these things like Tai Chi Chuan, which is sort of to do with space in front of you and your own body, relating body energies outside yourself, are to do with getting into a state of mind, I think, for the day and the work that you're doing and so on. And although they wouldn't really admit to it being a sort of traditional sort of thing to do with spiritual world or anything, I think it very much is that the people still feel in themselves that they have to be related outside themselves to the bigger universe, which is probably sort of Taoism and such like. Mm. Although Confucianism, of course, is being very heavily stamped on because it reduces the position of women and really suggests that the traditional form of society should always stay and that people should keep their own level and things. So there's been a big campaign going on just to try to get over those sort of Confucian ethics, which have been very destructive in Chinese life, probably.
What do you feel, what are the things you envy about China? What are the things you looked at and say, God, I wish we had some of that here?
Well, the best thing, the terrific thing, I think, is the whole spirit. Because you've got everybody in the country is working with each other towards improving life for everybody, it means that all the energy is very positive. It always feels positive. People feel very positive, very relaxed, not going frantic. They're not working frantically or anything. They're working in a very relaxed way. They seem to enjoy it. They relax at weekends. They go rowing on the lakes and take photographs of one another. And in the factories we went in and the communes, people would still sit down and they'd have their cups of tea and talk. And there weren't sort of, you know, little ants all the time running up and down.
That's a bit of a picture we have, I think.
Yeah. I think maybe they did work sort of much more like little ants when they were trying to build up their country very, very greatly because it was so low they really had to work very hard to get enough food and things. Now they've actually succeeded in building their country to a great extent. And so they don't have to be quite so sort of mad workers. So
it sounds marvellous. What are the drawbacks?
Well, let's just go on to the whole thing about working together. Because in our society we tend to sort of work against each other, because we're all brought up in our society to be individuals and to be competitive, really. And sort of we've got to build ourselves on other people. We sort of don't mind trampling on a few people in order to get somewhere. The Chinese wouldn't allow the freedom of the individual to actually trample on other parts of society in order to raise himself. So that's the big difference. Now, as we're brought up very much to sort of pull ourselves up and become heroes or stars of stage, screen, really, or whatever it is, it's very difficult for us to actually sort of really think or feel their way. And I'd find it quite difficult to fit into their society, especially the Chinese. Language
you have got to an extent subdue your individuality.
Yes, yes, because you'd have to mean changing yourself from being that way to being a sort of socially minded and very broad sense, and they're brought up that way and we're not, so that would take a time to get used to and might be very frustrating, because you could end up in a village with a group of people who are very sort of in some ways might be sort of pressurizing you against you in some way, you as an individual. Mm-hmm. And the attitude of the Chinese, if you're in that situation, you have to work with each other to try and, so you all realize, so you all walk up together. But if you were sort of person who couldn't quite cope, you could get very frustrated in that sort of situation. Whereas in another village or commune, where you're all working ahead together very well, it's very exciting, you really feel it. I mean, when you're in a place where they're really sort of going, they're just going, and they're going so fast. So well, you feel the whole country changing. And they've had 13 good years of agriculture now, so they've got good storage of grain and so on, and they use every inch of the ground I mean, every inch up to the factory walls is sort of used. And we're talking now about East China. Now, I think what they've done now, that's just a feeling I've got, is they've probably succeeded in bringing East China up to a pretty level of agriculture and simple industrialization.
Does the East separate itself from the West in that kind of way?
But geographically, the plain lands of China are in the East, and then you've got very big mountains, which are much more difficult to build roads and railways through. Then over the other side of the mountains, you've got the plateau and the desert sort of areas, Mongolia and so on. Mm.
The main portion of the population is in the East, is it?
I would think so, yes. So along the south, you've got the Jordan, the borders with Vietnam and Burma and so on, where you've got sort of hill tribes that are quite sort of different. Just remember, geographically, again, it's sort of quite tough. You haven't got many plane services or anything. And everything that they have got in transport is, of course, being used.
How do you travel most of the time?
All long distances by train. And one of the things they do to guests, they treat you as a guest. As a visitor to their country, they treat you as a guest. So you get these amazing sort of first-class carriages with sort of lace antimacassars.
First-class? They have first-class and second-class?
Yes, they do. There's some things that you still pay on buses too. The first class and second class in trains, I mean, shocks you immediately. You think, oh, hell, you know, they're not there.
I heard then you somebody start complaining about that on the British Rail the other day. Yeah.
We started asking about who uses the first class, and what actually happens is you get a lot of people using it who are having to go about the country a lot. Say for department stores, and they have big department stores, they belong to the people. But the buyers from these department stores go around the country to different industries, buying coats or radios or televisions.
A big portion of their life on trains.
Yes, and so they usually travel first class so they can actually work while they're in the train, and that sort of thing is actually
that's the excuse that the businessmen give also.
Probably, but I tend to believe the Chinese. You can be very cynical. I mean, one can, but I think they're trying very hard to
cope. Not really.
With
I hope you're not really cynical, because it sounds, you know, China just sounds so beautiful to me that I suppose an element of cynicism does creep in. Yes, you think to yourself, it can't be that good.
Well, they're very clever. I mean, they're amazing. When we first arrive, you don't sort of, you're not sure whether to trust your interpreters or whether they're there to check on you or stop you getting out or not to see things that they don't want you to see. And the whole time we're in China, we were never stopped from photographing, and we were always allowed to go out as we wished. They were worried about if we went out. They were worried because they thought we'd get lost, or that we'd get bitten by snakes or something, and they'd be very concerned if a guest of their coming to their country.
They're also presumably suspicious of you to an extent, that you might be looking for adverse publicity or whatever.
I think they're strong enough not to worry about that. They don't want it, and they were very annoyed with Antonioni in his filmmaking. I haven't seen his film, so I don't know. Because they felt that he was just playing the sort of film director, sort of star thing. And their whole attitude is it's always the people that they're interested in. The idea of a film director who tells everybody what to do, of course, is anathema. And to make sort of stars or great dramatic points. They're not really interested in dramatic, I don't think.
Incidentally, while we're on that, do they have a film industry?
Yes, quite big. One evening I went out into the city and we came to what we thought was a cinema because it had hundreds of bicycles outside. We asked if we could go in. I say we asked because they didn't speak any English and we didn't speak any Chinese, but we mentioned the fact that we wanted to try and go in and see what was happening inside. And they said, no, we weren't sure we weren't allowed to go in because what was happening inside or whether the film had sort of nearly finished or what. But we kept on sort of pushing a bit and they did take us in. And I think the reason they were saying no is because the film had nearly finished, actually. So I went up, they took us to a seat. They wouldn't take any money off us. We sat down and we watched this film, and it was a film about the communists fighting the Kuomintang, and there were a whole lot of American US tanks and things, you see, which the Kuomintang had all these tanks, and the communists were of course always winning. They were always just glowing, walking over and blowing everybody else up, and it was like a sort of Western. The goodies were always winning, but it was very well produced. They had marvellous sort of battle scenes of blowing up trucks, everywhere, a cast of thousands of things.
Entertaining.
Yeah, and the audience were enjoying it. Mm-hmm. And it seems they've got quite a big film industry. All their films are very like their posters or their other art. It's very much for the people, and they must be politically right. The director can't just decide to make a film. It has to be the people and the team. It's always teamwork. You decide what to make it on. You discuss what you're going to do, and when it's the right theme, and when it's according to political theory and so on.
I think, you know, artists in particular, any kind of creator, have very much more stake in the kind of individuality, particularly in the West, than most other people. Did you speak to any artists, writers, etc. in China, and do they find that a burden?
Well, of course, those that we find it a burden, we wouldn't be the ones we'd be speaking to, because I guess they've
disappeared.
Well, yes, there wouldn't be considered a positive element if a person is fighting for the individual, sort of his right to... You can paint what you like as an individual. You can go and buy your paints or buy your musical instruments and play them at home and paint to your heart's content. But if you're doing any art that you expect to put on show or part of the community work, you're expected to be painting as part of the people again. And a painter, some of these paintings we've got here are actually painted by the peasants in the countryside, and they, after they'd been working in the fields, there was a lady there who actually started educating, showing how to paint, and got a lot of the ordinary peasants painting ordinary scenes from their own lives. So planting rice or looking after ducks and things. Now they painted them, and a lot of them are painted on the walls of the houses. So they're not sort of art that you can go and buy or will go in a gallery. It's painted on the wall of the house. And when they paint them, the people come and say, oh no, you know, you're not being truthful there. You've got to remember, you must put the power lines in. It's very important, you know, we've got power lines or electric lights hanging there. And so or trucks, you can't be sort of romantic about it. The people come in and actually say to the artist, you must do this, and talk to the artist. And the same in plays. And we talked to a playwright, and he said that the idea for the play can either come from himself or from the group of people he's working with, because he might be working in a factory, not an artist or a playwright or anything, isn't just sitting up in his ivory tower, he's working.
It's never a full-time occupation?
There's no real sort of full-time intellectual occupation. I mean, everybody spends a certain amount of time in the fields or in the country or in the factories anyway. I don't know whether there'd be any full-time playwrights or not. There are some sort of full-time editors for papers, and so the people who sort of are doing printing for posters and things might be a full-time sort of job, because they're workers who are doing it. And there are artists on the stage who are full-time doing acrobatics and things, so I think there could be full-time playwrights.
Mm-hmm. So isn't there a village of painters also in the south? I mean, I know John Berger and David Nadella went there a couple of years ago, and it was a whole unified painters commune. I mean,
Well, they grow their own food too.
Yes.
There's a book just come out, which is the Hoseon County Peasant Painters, of which these at this end, these four are very similar to their paintings, copied from their paintings. And that's a whole county, which is an area where the people have got together and got rather good at painting. But the basis of the village wouldn't be a sort of painting village. The basis of the community would be this, and then in the spare time they also got into painting. There's a tradition in China traditionally, as we went across China, we saw houses with sort of paintings on the walls anyway, maybe of a tree, a sort of that sort of thing in the mist going across and things, and they're still being done. And quite often you get the traditional scrolls with the plum blossom and all the symbolic sort of things. But again, they'll probably quite often have a power line in or a dam as a background rather than just the lake. The lake will actually be an artificial lake. So the two have come together to still produce things that people enjoy. Mm-hmm. Now,
enjoyment is an essential element, because it's very difficult to, for instance, in Western society to kind of give a reason for art, where what is it and why is it? They presumably must have come across that even more so when it is necessary to do a lot of hard work to build up a country from a very low level. How do you justify the existence of art? How do you justify somebody spending time painting?
Well, you have a certain amount of spare time which you do as you wish, and you might sort of go knitting, and you might do beautiful embroidery, or you might go and visit your parents, or you might decide to paint. Or you might decide to make music. They're very keen on music. Musical instruments are very cheap. A lot of them play music. They sing songs, or they might do a lot of political education. they might decide to write a book. They can really do what they like,
yes.
And the community will help them do it.
It's
a very
spare
positive
time activity.
Yes. Yeah.
There's nothing of kind of professionalism about it, as it were.
The idea of a professional being different is not, yeah. Is not the point.
Mm-hmm.
If this, as a society develops, if the people are in a village and they're saying to this person who's painting on the wall, that's great, let's do this. Now the people are raising their own consciousness of what art is, what they want. Well, as time goes on, as they work with each other, it might become much more sort of abstract or experimental. As they've got more time, more people might do it. But it'll come out of the culture, the whole people moving up to a different level, rather than some people just being very high and some people being very low, not understanding us. So you've only got a sort of, the workers in Britain don't really have anything to do with Picasso sort of thing. They, I think, will try and move the whole lot up together.
Yeah.
And I think you might get a very, very big flowering of a totally new sort of cultural ethic, which could be very experimental, and it could arise very quickly. Because they're very keen on doing things, and they do them so well. I mean, you look at the acrobatics and things, it's unbelievable what they do.
Yes.
They also integrate the minority groups and the minority arts and languages, of which we must remember that China is mostly Han-dominated race, who wear all the blue clothes, similar things to this. Although this particular jacket is a lower middle peasant's jacket, and I bought it in France. You can't even buy them in China.
You seem to have acquired some Chinese features in your 3 weeks as well.
I think so. Yeah. Gee, I don't know. I had a beard when I was there. People find beards strange on young people. Also, they find Westerners strange. And when you go walking around a town, people will come and look at you. They're not unfriendly, they're sort of very friendly. It's just a shame you can't communicate.
It's true,
with them.
It's everywhere in the East, actually. I think
yes,
it's not
I guess in different places. They're not silly, like they are in some places. India, they'll try and buy your watch all the time or something. Chinese are very interesting because they don't see many Westerners. There's about 60,000 visitors to China each year at the moment. They haven't got facilities for having very many visitors. They're not sure whether they should have such a thing as tourism. They're not certain whether it makes great sense.
Mm-hmm.
They're not interested in it for making money out of it. They can cope with their own economy can cope with itself. I think mostly at the moment, I like the idea of people coming so they can, because they're interested in people being interested in them, and it promotes a sort of idea of their sort of alternative and communist society, which they're aiming for, of course. And so there are quite a few Vietnamese in China sort of, as guests, and there are quite a few African people as guests, because they're very much, and we saw quite a few Arabs too as we're going around. The Canadians are popular because they've had good relationships with China. French have had good relationships with China, and so on. For instance, the French have had good relationships because early on in the revolution, a lot of the young Chinese revolutionaries went to China, went to Paris to study communism. And Mao himself nearly went, and a lot of his friends went. And so then they went back, and so there are a lot of contacts again. Whereas Britain really hasn't done a lot for being pro-Chinese, and we really took advantage of them for a long time. Mm. We've always rather dithered.
The French also don't have a terribly good record in the Far East.
No, but there was no colonial war in China from the French.
Yes, the French didn't have interest,
no,
didn't they? Yes, they did.
Started with Ho Chi Minh, in fact, being a member of the French Communist Party and being at the first Congress in 1926. I think it goes back to that also. There's been a tradition.
Yes,
in
yes, the French tradition is strong.
Much more, between the two countries. That once England was considered very much a very colonialist country, very imperialistic.
We do behave in rather an English way. Most of the English visitors to China traditionally, and the ambassadors and people haven't really been very socialist orientated.
They take cucumber sandwiches with them.
Yes, that sort of thing. I still feel it's so in the diplomatic circles.
We have the idea also of China being, in some senses, anti-America, or at least of America being anti-China. What is the feeling in China about America?
The Chinese are never, say, anti-America. They're not against the people, they're always with the people of any country. They say, we're with the American people, even if we're against their leaders and the big capitalist sort of companies and things. But they're always with the people of a country, they're interested in people's revolution. And it is definitely, and you feel it all the time, it's a country that's run by the people, for the people. And this is the key element, and it isn't so necessarily in our countries.
Tony, thank you very much.
Thank you. little known and very short book has survived from the pen of Shen Kua, which gives us a fascinating glimpse of the travelling methods of this omnivorous observer. It is the Wong Hua Lu. In it he describes the best way to make an official inspection carriage comfortable, how to arrange that from the lacquered interior one shall get a good view of the scenery or other objects of interest, and what are the most essential things to take with one in one's travelling cases. Here he mentions a chest of medicines, plenty of spare clothes, food, tea, another containing paper, ink, scissors, a rhyming dictionary, and a lute. Candles, knives, chessmen, and a folding chessboard are not to be forgotten. And a box should be prepared to receive books, which may be bought on, together with some insecticide powder for keeping worms away from them. Lastly, he advises that a mud boat should be taken, as there are some places which cannot be reached by any other method.
Mantainer. The Mantainer idea had been with Tony for some years now, and in October 1973, the Mantainer unit in the AA, focusing most of its brief in developing different aspects of the one-man resources, self-contained energy suitcase for living in.
Most of the year's work was based in Italy. We travelled down through Paris, Germany and Switzerland to Venice, where we were based for 3 weeks, but soon decided to move on to a Tuscany farmhouse near Lucca. The whole group lived Italian history, ecology, peasant and padrone life, wine, bread, salad and olive oil. At the same time, working on Mantainer and designing and building a mock-up.
Each individual in the group wished to explore him or herself and various ideas, sometimes alone, sometimes together. The different studies being overlaid with lectures and trips based on the means of production and consumption and designs of houses for various ideologies. The explorations opened the group up to one another, and in November culminated in a theatrical event by Scott and Charlene, which rather shook the school and necessitated a reanalysis of our direction and a presentation by the unit in Earlham Street. Individuals then approached a broad range of topics.
What you've just been seeing is the collapse of the Tacoma Bridge, which was a major engineering disaster in this century. Quite amazing they got it on film. I've been working on my thesis, which is called Design for Emergencies. I'm a fourth year student. My name is Margot Sagov. I've been really trying to define the problem this year. I've not been particularly involved in design work. I've been reading and collecting information, which I have in files. And I've written a little bit here, which I'll read. It is called a scenario of a typical random aid situation where everyone loses. A disaster strikes in a small village. The villagers' religious beliefs make them react in a number of negative ways. Allah's will, so don't try and do anything. Because of ignorance, some of the villagers are allowed to die without any sensible treatment. Some of them drink polluted water and there's fear of an epidemic. Many people seem to be wandering about aimlessly, crowding around injured people with morbid curiosity. Others steal whatever they can and run away, in spite of the government decree that looters will be shot on sight. The black market in soybeans is thriving, the mayor having been bribed by a corrupt civil servant in the employ of the CIA. The media exaggerate. You can substitute minimize according to the particular media policy. While it takes the government 3 days and 57 bottles of whiskey to decide to appeal for international assistance and declare a national state of emergency and mourning. The beloved president's wife is seen waving to disaster victims as they are flown into the capital. Friendly countries donate large quantities of evening gowns, tomato ketchup, and vitamin pills in return for a few small trade concessions. Newspapers publish photographs of aircraft being loaded and smiling army colonels with smiling orphans. Conflicting information and rumors abound. No relief organization will divulge any information for fear that the other rival groups will use it to their disadvantage. There's much confusion and duplication. The experts from the West can't speak the local dialect, which alarms the survivors in the village who have traditionally despised the gringos anyway. Remember how they massacred our forefathers. They refuse to eat the relief meals which contain prohibited substances and give them a great bellyache. In fact, there's a rumor going around the camp that the Christian aid food contains poison. The monsoon season doesn't make it any easier for the Land Rovers to get through the mountain tracks, and many have to be abandoned as there's no service for Land Rovers in that country. Bandits have been known to attack the trucks bearing foodstuffs and clothing. The stench and misery in the camp seem to grow daily as they begin the inquiry regarding the disappearance of some allocated funds. A high-up government official commits suicide, and we can all stay home and watch it on TV.
This is François Lalouse, working outside a Mantainer. He started as a bum, not really designing, but showing the attitude of life in a space, which is walking and sleeping accommodation, and an eating kit, and facing a wall in a room, just like St. Mungo's Community Trust. They squat houses to house bums in winter. What is an anti-architecture? But then what's architecture? perhaps it's Mantainer's. He also spent some time in Ettington Park, exploring the intangible environment. Meanwhile, some people looked at the communication system of telephones, but François looked at the house and he found its ghosts. The ideological house. This project was thinking about Ledoux. Ledoux, the revolutionary architect of the late 18th century in France, often cited. Ledoux's buildings as clashing surfaces, hazardous buildings, chevronous with heterogeneous materials.
Now, this is paraphernalia designed for an object. It's an imposing sculpture, and that's the elevation. It's a place to walk in and out, where there's activities, and all related to the plan, which is like a car.
I joined the unit because I wanted to interrogate approaches to architecture other than those I'd looked at the year before, which was doing designs for houses. I'd also spent a bit of time looking at houses around New York, and they rather sickened me. So I looked at approaches such as perfectionism to getting everything perfect, and I used a watchmaker's spyglass to do the drawings and drew in the cracks and the planks. And its anecdote was the report by Tony that was just on a piece of scrappy paper and scrappy writing, and it kind of balanced out the perfection. And I looked at brainwashing, and really the fact that perhaps the world could go by with people being under complete control of one person. This man, Bentham, designed the Panopticon, and it was a prison in which the director looked at the warden, who looked at the prisoner, who looked at the blank walls, who looked back at the prisoner, and they all tried to understand themselves by being by themselves for 10 years. And as a reaction to that, I tried to formulate a free house where you could make the choice of doing things yourself. And all you needed was a pile of rope and a roll of plastic. And you stretched the rope and put the plastic within it, and you'd got yourself a house. And the next approach towards a free house was to have a large glassed-in area like this with plants in it, and an overhead crane with Mantainers hanging from them. And you lived like that. Again, you could do exactly as you wished. And another thing was to look at an approach towards architecture that Chris Crickmay had studied, which was interrogating something until its real meaning was understood. And this is a word, medicine. And I went down the list, and down the list, and down the list, and down the list, and down the list, until I'd come to an understanding that medicine was more than just pills and penicillin. And in fact, you perhaps needed a building which gave you something more than pills. I wanted to examine the ways people did things at present and have reassembled them in this building. Another thing was to find out basic skills, and I learned how to do silkscreen printing. And most important was to work with wood. And this little book called The Woodworker's Pocketbook has got every fact about wood. For instance, in hammers, it's got four hammers: the Warrington pattern, the London pattern, the claw, and the pattern makers. Thank you.
Among other things, Richard and I have been doing some research work on the design and building of a portable wind generator. This machine will abstract energy from unlimited, pollution-free sources and convert it into electricity and store it for later use in batteries. It is designed to match up to the expected energy needs of the Mantainer unit and can be folded down into the unit. Testing models in wind tunnels, working with all different tools and materials in the workshop, scavenging goods from large companies and rubbish dumps. A tool that can free humankind from the power system.
Murray, in solving architectural problems, one becomes increasingly aware of the vast number of choices of materials, styles, patterns of circulation, and so on, open to one. And an ability to discriminate between each choice is necessary. Choices are often predetermined. One has made a decision to operate in a particular political climate with political economic constraints, and with the addition of the big idea based on popular symbolic imagery and a pile of manufacturers' catalogues of materials, some the designer has never touched, perhaps even never seen, a piece is produced. Now I've attempted to reduce my choice by making assessment of materials, by drawing photography, so on, so that decisions are made for me by their own particular qualities. Now, let's consider one man, my next door neighbor. His slates have fallen off his roof. Now, an architect would purport to be able to make certain decisions about how to replace his roof. And to him, visual truth may be important. With two choices open to him, asbestos slates or real slates, he chooses the cheapest, asbestos slates. Obvious advantages. In order to keep the street's consistent roofline, he has to put slate. Now, slate changes from a soft brown grey to almost black in rain. But do asbestos slates have those same qualities? No. The only reason we accept that it looks like slate is because of its size and the fact that it's on a roof. Now, asbestos slates are manufactured in an entirely different process from real slates, of course. A process that doesn't necessitate that the material be used in any one size. So why the same size? Now that man's no fool. He's able to interpret the fine stylistic differences between a 66 and a 67 Cortina. He's just spent £2,000 on a new one, polishes it every Sunday. Now would you catch him touching up the paintwork with oil paint or immersion? Of course not.
Able to look upon the distant earth. He sees it to be green from the verdure on the land, algae greening the oceans, a green celestial fruit. Looking closely at the earth, he perceives blotches, black, brown, grey, and from them extend dynamic tentacles upon the green epidermis. These blemishes he recognizes as the cities and works of man, and he asks, is man but a planetary disease? If it is true that we don't understand first principles, then it would be natural and well-mannered for us to scale down for a while and start again from the bottom. One of Gandhi's main tenets was that a small, correct movement can be enlarged when it is seen and understood to be so correct. Large, impulsive movements may injure and leave permanent scars. History is what is left of these injuries. I don't think that we know anything about the future. The Indian hunting sites that have been unearthed during the building of the Alaskan oil pipeline have been carbon dated at 200 years in the future. I've spent the year trying to imagine various utopian notions into an estate in Scotland. The estate is falling apart. Such anachronistic land tenures tend to be subdivided or sold to Bolivian 10 million yields, or turned into hunting and fishing retreats for European industrialists, or rented to oil service industries, or rented piecemeal to holiday makers. None of these ideas, however economic, do anything to explore or understand man's place in nature. They're characteristically greedy and ugly and destructive. These activities will no doubt continue. At the same time, a number of groups of people break off from the compulsive replaying of history. It is not a matter of either or, it's as well.
Early in the school year, my interest manifested itself in the forms and shapes houses and rooms would take. When I began the first stages of design and model making, I realized the genesis of a theme that would reoccur through my work. That is, the form of architecture inlaid within the land, or rather the contours of the land, giving rise to a language which expresses the design of buildings. However, at this present time, the elements to formulate this concept have begun to gel. In retrospect, the year has been a culmination of experiments in design and form, which has indicated a future potential and direction. It has been a personal insight into myself and the foundation in the understanding which forms may expand and their success be ensured. In the beginning, the primary objective is form, in which dynamics plays the most important role. It is the interreaction of shapes that most interests me. As I continued, I considered the possibilities of a machine in which the mechanisms inside would help stimulate other individuals' conceptions and their flights of fantasy. In a sense, the design for all states of architecture and minds. The culmination of this year has been a deep study into my earlier themes of earth meeting architecture. I investigated different cultures and their attitudes towards the earth, myth, mysticism, and religion being the basic mode of the investigation, from the Chinese natural science of Feng Shui to the Aboriginal Australian totemism of the land. A constant theme has been manifested. The last project of this year, the health center, personally represents a successful use of a deep building site in which the large structure was inverted and allowed to grow downward. Mantainer represents a vehicle in which we may develop ourselves individually, but each of our work and our confrontation between each other influencing the design and thoughts involved. As a unit, it then becomes a presentation into developing alternatives to contain and maintain man and his potential.
Serge, I'm trying to evolve an understanding between people and buildings. Buildings, shapes, objects encountered by people in their homes, where they work, and in the places where they move through. Why are some buildings a great delight, while others are oppressive? I've started from the inside, looking out. My experience as an interior designer, trying within the shapes I've designed to express the activities about which people will use them, trying to create a response to activity in the shape of things, the line of the form, rather than applied decoration. The objects, spaces, and shapes express a dynamic derived from the function specified by the need of people and allowed for by structure. Structure capturing whim, spirit, and gesture. Basic human traits, I think. People are dynamic. The sketches show the human form frozen, freezing the human form in motion and deriving a dynamic from its structure. Posture will express stance and activity, features the spirit in which it was undertaken. Look at buildings. In the built form, which is generally static, so no need to freeze it, one can derive a dynamic from its structure. Its posture will express stance and activity, features in which it was undertaken. So buildings too should be dynamic.
Okay, I'm going to leave it there.
Unit of body and mind, spiritually by incorporating psychological images in design environments, theatrically by using body in live performance, physically by studying brain and body systems, personally by using movement and dance, visually through the silkscreen medium, using the person as subject. Architecturally, by the design of ritualistic total house environments.
In the region of 200 kilowatts a square mile. But so far, its utilization has remained economically unviable. After the last war, an attempt was made in several